giving you in-depth political analysis, tackling the issues of the Jewish world. Here's Jake Stern on Yeshiva World Radio.
Thank you, Rick Santos. As you've heard by now, last week an Iranian nuclear scientist and his bodyguard were driving along, suddenly approached by two motorcyclists covered in black who proceeded to attach magnetic bombs to his car and detonate, blow up the scientists. No Miss Oskim services were required, by the way. And everybody's blaming the Israelis and the Mossad. Why would that be? Maybe the Saudis pulled this off. I don't know, maybe it was Al-Qaeda in Yemen. Maybe the reason that everybody thinks it's Israel is because Israel is the only country that actually has the guts to attack Iran dead on instead of wasting time with these sanctions while the Iranians can just develop more and more uranium and enrich it and create these nuclear weapons. Pretty much Israel's doing the dirty work for all these other countries. Or maybe everybody's blaming the Mossad because they're the only organization out there that could pull this off so seamlessly as they have time and time again. And there's actually a report out there that part of the United States' military strategy to deal with the Iranian closure of the Straits of Hormuz, which they keep threatening to do, and pulling off all these maneuvers in those straits, very, very scary. Well, the United States military, their strategy involves dolphins. That's right, if the Iranians lay mines, and they have thousands of mines that they may lay, and they're threatening to plant all across the straits, it seems that dolphins are excellent minesweepers. The Ayatollah has got to be shaking in his boots with this one, the old dolphin strategy. Next, they're going to have the cavalry marching horseback into Tehran. And no wonder Barack Obama just cut $450 billion out of the Defense Department, because apparently we're replacing military technology with flipper. You cannot make it up. And here's the best part, is the animal rights lunatics apparently are upset that we're going to be implementing dolphins because we're risking the dolphins' lives. They're going to get into harm's way. They're going to find these bombs and mines and possibly detonate them in the process and blow themselves up. It's just really unbelievable. The more Iran news, and we're going to give you a lot more here coming up a little bit later. I am just so troubled by the response here of the Obama administration as things continue to escalate. Of course, the Iranians just sentenced an American citizen to death, and that was followed up by this attack by the motorcyclists. You wonder if there was some kind of connection there. We're going to get into all the coverage, all the analysis a little bit later. And by the way, the latest, as reported right here on YWN, is that the United States is getting ready to set Israel up as the scapegoat to blame them if things escalate and if we do end up with some sort of military confrontation in Iran, because the Israelis, by all reports and by all accounts, are very close to taking matters into their own hands. They're just not going to wait around for these sanctions to take effect, which they don't seem, they're taking some effect, I shouldn't say none, but it's too little at this point and too late. And the Israelis are planning some sort of military intervention. The United States has been warning them not to. Easy for them to say on the halfway across the world while the Israelis are sitting ducks. But what the United States is saying now, here's the rhetoric, is, well, if Israel were to preempt the Iranian nuclear facilities with some sort of attack, then that would create turmoil in the Middle East. So they're setting up to blame the Israelis. Now, if there's heightened, escalated military confrontation, it's not the Iranians. They're the ones who are building this nuclear weapon. They're the ones who are threatening Israel and literally threatening many countries across the globe. They're not the ones to blame. It's Israel's fault because Israel actually attacked the Iranians and started this whole thing off. What are they, nuts? So I'm getting really fired up about this. We'll have all of that coming up here on the Jake Stern Show. Jake Stern at theyeshivaworld.com if you'd like to get in touch. We have a great show for you coming up in a moment. Rabbi Yisrael Friedman, the main shadchan of Gateway Connections, and he writes for the Yated, for the Shidduch Forum. He'll do an excellent job to discuss the Shidduch crisis and all sorts of issues, plus lots more. And one other point here before we get to that. Thank you, YWN, for bringing to our attention the Philharmonic, which was brought to a stop by somebody's cell phone that went off right in the middle of a symphony. Does this sound familiar? We here on the Jake Stern Show have been ranting for weeks about how disgraceful it is, the constant ringing of cell phones in shul. And I'll grant you there's a difference. People only go to the Philharmonic, I don't know, once or twice a year. I personally never go to the Philharmonic. But it's not the same as walking into a shul three times a day. I'll grant you that. But this has never happened before, that the Philharmonic actually had to be stopped. The conductor just sat there glaring at whoever it was whose cell phone was going off. And look at the respect that they have for a symphony. This symphony is actually more sacred than davening in shul. Now, come on. Just put the phone on vibrate. Just leave it on vibrate all day, as I do. What's the big deal? I'm not talking to doctors or Hatzolah people, but pretty much everybody else could get by if the phone is on cell phone. They literally stop the orchestra from playing. And what if we did that in shul, by the way? Is that going too far? What if we just stop davening and just everybody sort of glare at the person until they take their cell phone ringing and get it out of the shul? I've seen that, by the way, when a child is crying, that everyone will just sort of stare the parent down. The child just go on and on, totally disrupt davening, and people won't stand for it. And, you know, is that going too far? That's another thing that irks me, by the way. We're going to have to wait for a different show to discuss that. All right, we're going to go to our very special guest, and then... after that, we'll discuss the recent events in Eretz Yisrael, lots more on Iran, coming up. Rabbi Yisrael Friedman is the main shadchan of Gateways Connections. He also has a very enjoyable column in the Ated as part of the Shidduch Forum. Here now on the Jake Stern Show on The Yeshiva World, Rabbi Yisrael Friedman, thank you for being here.
How are you?
I'm doing great. Baruch Hashem, how are you?
Fantastic, Baruch Hashem. I'm just getting started. It's 11:12 p.m. These are basically my prime time hours right now.
I'm with you. That's why we arrange it this time, so I'm glad we're on the same page. We're going to get to the Gateways program a little bit later, as well as everybody's favorite topic, unfortunately, the Shidduch crisis. First, I want to discuss individual girls' and families' predicaments. I think we all know girls in situations 23, 24 years old, which I guess in Shidduchim is when people start to get a little bit concerned and your heart goes out to them. I notice there are times when they feel somewhat helpless. And I'm talking about good, regular, solid girls who will meet with Shadchanim and then they'll wait for that phone call. And maybe sometimes they'll go weeks or even months without a phone call, or at least without getting set up with a date. And my question is, what advice can you give people to be a little more proactive? To me, it seems on the one hand, they don't want to drive people crazy, but sometimes it seems like the pushy people maybe get ahead. And is there a way they can network? Should they be more pushy? What are your thoughts?
Well, I'll tell you like this. You know, I have a guy who calls me every day for the last 3 years, and he leaves a message on my phone. He goes, "Hi, it's whatever, Yitzhak Singer," or whatever, anonymous. And this is the 731st time I'm calling you without a response.
It sounds like me trying to book this interview, by the way.
Right, exactly. But the bottom line, that is abusive. And the Shadchanim were only one person. Most people don't have secretaries or private secretaries. I know I definitely don't have one. There's thousands of people out there, and it's really impossible to service every single person. You know, you want to get the point across to the Shadchan, and there's a lot of Shadchanim out there that are doing good, and usually most Shidduchim are not made by professional Shadchanim. Most Shidduchim are still made primarily by your close friends and family. And Shadchanim, you should look like as to an added bonus. The people that you should really be networking are your close friends and family that know you, that are going to be advocating for you, because a Shadchan, at the end of the day, he's just someone that met you for 3 minutes or 7 minutes by a chasna. He doesn't know that much about you, and he doesn't have the perspective to be able to match you up. And, you know, he doesn't really, you know, it's not, he's not advocating on your behalf like a close family friend. So a shadchan is, you should be looking at a professional shadchan as somebody who could possibly make your shidduch, but definitely don't put your eggs all in that basket, because that's a big mistake. How do you get through to a shadchan? I would suggest, you know, calling a shadchan is basically like calling, you know, I don't want to put myself on a pedestal here, but it's really impossible to get through to Shulchanim, and rightfully so. My phone rings every 30 seconds. Every 30 seconds, my phone rings. So it's fine. You know, I'm in the pizza shop with my kids. I'm not picking up the phone to talk about your daughter, you know, for a reminder. The best way to get through to Shulchanim nowadays, Baruch Hashem, we have technology. You can email the Shulchanim. Friendly reminder. Don't expect a response, you know, because, again, at the end of the night, I have to look through about 350 emails, and if I do respond K or working on something, you know, people get offended more than if I don't respond at all. So, you know, just look at it as a friendly reminder. Hi, I'm still around. This is my resume. Don't put capital letters in your email because that's already borderline abusive. You know, like people email me all the time things like, are you still a shadchan? ? Capital letters. Are you doing this anymore? Why do you have nothing for my daughter? You know, a shadchan doesn't owe you anything.
And they're being sarcastic.
Yes, they're being sarcastic. Shadchanim don't owe you anything, but we're out there for the good of the people, and we're trying to help out. But you know, we can't service everybody. So, you know, we try, and I try to set up as many people as I can, because when you set somebody up, usually they can't have tainas on you. Some people have more tainas on you after you set them up than beforehand. So then you're a catch 22. But basically, we are the punching bag for society. everything is the Shadchan's fault. You know, Shadchan can do no right. We caused this shit a crisis, but in essence, most of the Shadchanim out there, I'm not talking about myself, but most Shadchanim out there are really, really special people, and they're just trying to help people out, and they have rachmanis, and all the myths and theories that we're doing it for the money is such a joke, because the biggest Shadchan in the world could make about 20, 25 Shadchanim a year, and that 25 Shadchanim, on average, Shadchanim is making $3,000 to $4,000, get paid less than the 9-to-5 accountant that gets to go home at night and actually spend time with their family. And we don't get any time to spend with our family. Today was Sunday afternoon. My wife went to some sort of museum, and I was on the phone the whole time because the shidduch was about to break, and it was very tedious, and it was time sensitive. And if I wasn't there, I couldn't play with my kids, and I couldn't do anything, because otherwise the shidduch would have fell apart, and we wouldn't have, Dairus of this young, beautiful Zivig. So, obviously, we have our priorities straight. We know that, you know, something is time-sensitive. We drop everything. You know, I was in the hospital. My wife was giving birth to a baby, and my wife was in labor. And I picked up the phone because I knew a shidduch was very, very, you know, very, very sensitive.
Wow.
And I said, listen, buddy, my wife is in labor right now. I cannot talk. She said, okay, fine, great, but when can I call you back? People are... You know, they care, you know, they want to, they, you know, when you're dealing with your shidduch, and I'm sure it's going to be the same way when I'm dealing with shidduch my kids, there's nothing else in the world that counts other than that shidduch. You know, it's the most important thing in the world. They can't understand somebody else is having a baby. It doesn't make a difference to them, you know. And I don't blame those people. I'm just saying that we are under tremendous, tremendous pressure, and that's something that we deal with, but don't make us into the punching bag. That's
Rabbi Friedman, I'm getting these subtle vibes that you feel somewhat unappreciated, and the truth is I'm very happy to be getting the Shadchan's point of view and perspective out there, because as you say, you guys get a bad rep, and here you are trying to save society, trying to do what you can to help, and like you allude to, the more you help, the more you're setting yourself up to get the blame when things go bad, which is pretty incredible. But what I'm hearing from you is people can, to some extent, bug you, and you're open to that. It's much more that they have this attitude that you owe them something, and they just completely give you a bad rep and don't appreciate you, as opposed to realizing how much you're really doing for them and sort of realizing their role and being a little bit more humble about it.
Right. Well, first of all, I want to clarify. There's no greater sipuk in the world than making a shidduch. Making a shidduch is one of the most glorious accomplishments a person could do. You brought somebody together for the rest of their natural life, as long as they're married. We'll get to that later. They are indebted to you. It's somebody that they're going to talk about for the rest of their life. Oh, so who made your shidduch? It's a story that they're going to be speaking about 30 years from now, way after you have forgotten their name. Because, in the last 3 years, I've made around 70, I don't know, some shidduchim. I'm doing this for 3.5 years, and the bottom line is that I don't even remember. A lot of times I meet people on the street and say, oh, you know, especially like a girl that I met for like 5 minutes, and I meet her and she says, oh, you made my shidduch, and I have no recollection of, what's your name again? Oh, right, Taka. I have to remind myself. But for them, you did them the greatest chesed in the world. You know, Rav Nosson Vachfeigel always said, don't go to a chasana of a shidduch you made, because it's impossible for them to properly be makartayv to you. You did them the greatest chesed that you could ever do. So I want to clarify my point that, you know, as much as, you know, we feel used and abused and we feel, you know, like we're not getting, you know, the proper gratification, those are the downsides. When you make the shidduch, that's, you know, that's when you get the W, it's the greatest feeling, it's the most exhilarating feeling in the world. And Lamaisa, every day I open up the mail, and there's a thank you letter from someone, a beautifully written letter, somebody actually bought, so I have poems, my wife has a scrapbook of poems, we have hundreds of poems written about me, that I'm, you know, da-da-da, the Shatchin, you know, and all types of, like, ridiculous, you know, things that people send either for to remember your daughter or, you know, and it's really beautiful, and I really appreciate it, and if anybody out there is listening, thank you for giving me the opportunity to be a shadchan, and it's an amazing feeling. I wouldn't be doing it if there was no, you know, sipuk, you know, lemaisa, you know, I could be doing anything. I mean, you know, I could be doing, now it's a terrible job market, but, you know, I could be selling mortgages, I could have gone to school, I could have become an accountant, but I chose to do this because this is an amazing field to be in. It's tremendously, tremendously gratifying.
That is beautiful. Let's get to the actual dating process for a moment. Should people be more open to settling on things? Are there people who kind of get up there and they're still insisting on things that maybe aren't really necessary and aren't as crucial to looking for a spouse? And do they lose out on good shidduchim as a result?
Well, the process that I find, you know, settling is a very, very strong word. You know, Amol in the Friede Gezeiten, does the crowd here speak Yiddish?
I'm assuming I think they can handle it.
Okay. you know, the shidduch was made in the shtetl with the baker's son to the winemaker's daughter, you know. The options weren't, you know, as infinite as they are today. You know, you weren't going from Baranovich to Kletsk to make a shidduch. You know, you got married to somebody in the shtetl or sometimes, you know, on rare occasions outside, but, you know, so you could say that people were settling much more back then than they are today because, you know, their options were very limited. So people ask me, do you think people should be settling more today? It's not, yeah, I think definitely today people are much more fine-tuned and much more picky, and they have the right to be picky because there's a tremendous, tremendous networking and technology, and somebody from Australia can get married to somebody from Los Angeles today. We have the internet. We have so many beautiful tools that can bring people together from hundreds and thousands of miles away from each other. So definitely nowadays, shidduchim, it's a lot more complicated than it was, you know, Amol. But, you know, settling, as far as settling goes, you know, people, what I find is they come into shidduchim when they're 18 and a half years old, and they have this huge list of thousands of everything, you know, we're looking for this type of thing and that type of thing. And the bottom line is that most of that list falls away, and the primary things that are important always stay on the list, you know, like good midos, and a solid, you know, if a person's looking for someone who's a learning boy, you know, a solid Ben Torah or a solid, you know, a person with a solid career. Those are the things that are, you know, always stay on the list. But, you know, the other things when it comes to family and all these other, you know, I mean, family is obviously very important, but, you know, the girl should be taller, she should be shorter, she should be this, she should have that, she should be better dressed, she should be more out of towny, more in towny, less out of towny. All these little nuances and, you know, stupidities that people are busy with when they're just starting the shidduch process eventually become very, very moot and not, you know, not relevant. And people marry somebody that they, you know, Lamaisa, when you get somebody into a boy and a girl on a date and they have the right chemistry with each other, they're attracted to each other, and they have the right values and they respect each other, that will go a million miles quicker than if the girl's family has money or this, or the boy's family is more prestigious. You know, all these things, you know, are fall off of the wayside, you know, eventually.
Jake Stern, Yeshiva World News. We are talking with Rabbi Yisrael Friedman of Gateways Connections, also writes for the Shidduch Forum and the Ated. Do you find, Rabbi Friedman, that girls are more sophisticated these days than boys? Girls are obviously, well, within reason, out in the working world, and they're seeing a lot more of the world, in contrast with yeshiva guys, who, you know, we all know that yeshiva is not necessarily the most sophisticated environment.
So it's an interesting question. I think girls that are, you know, girls that are sophisticated, they're sophisticated regardless of how out in the world they are, or how, you know, how out in the working force they are. You know, a sophisticated girl is a sophisticated girl. And a sophisticated boy, regardless of what yeshiva he's learning in now, or, if, you know, what law school he's in right now, he's a sophisticated boy. So to answer your question, I mean, obviously, the girls out there have a much more solid educational background, as far as secular education, than any boy, because most girls, they start the BA process when they're 17 and a half, and by the time they're 21, they could already be on their PhD program. I know my wife is an occupational therapist. She's already working on her PhD right now. Right now she's 28, but I'm saying by when she was 22, she already had a full master's, and by me, my basic education ended in 10th grade, and my teachers weren't exactly the most fantastic. You know, I was learning yeshiva, the English there was pretty much, I don't want to say it was a joke, because it was probably better than most yeshivas, but, you know, still wasn't exactly the most sophisticated secular English, as you can tell by my vocabulary. So in regards to, you know, secular, you know, education, definitely girls are much more sophisticated in the education department. But, you know, there's a lot of very, very articulate, brilliant yeshiva boys that are, you know, very, very sophisticated. You know, they're very worldly, they read newspapers, they know about politics, they can go into the business world and they can tear it up. So, you know, again, everything is relative. I don't think girls are that much more sophisticated. You know, a girl, at the end of the day, most girls, you know, their primary focus is to be a mother, their primary focus is to build a bias neman. So I think that, you know, it evens itself out. You know, I've had some girls that were going for PhDs in Columbia, and they married guys that were, you know, they maybe have a PhD in Cheskos Abatim, but they don't, you know what I mean? They don't have any, they have absolutely no background, and they probably, their last English, they learned in yeshiva that didn't have English in ninth grade. And the shidduch works, because, you know, those guys could relate, they read newspapers, they know what's going on in the world. You know, a smart guy could pick up anything, and I don't find that it makes that big of a difference if a guy is a yeshiva boy or if he's really, really outside in the world in regards to marriage. You know, obviously, a girl's looking for a educated guy, someone's going to be a lawyer, so, you know, she's looking in the wrong place if she's going for a BMG guy. It's just the wrong area, but, you know, sophistication, I don't feel like it's that big of a gap. That's all I'm saying.
Very, very interesting. So many fascinating points there by Rabbi Friedman. We're going to bring you part two of that interview, where we discuss the Shidduch crisis and the age gap, among other things, a little bit later in the week, right here on the Jake Stern Show. Coming up, we will tell you more about the Iran crisis, including we're going to play a clip from last show where we on the Jake Stern Show actually predicted this attack by the motorcyclists on the nuclear scientists. I didn't know when it was going to happen, but we'll play that clip for you. I thought that was pretty interesting. Right now, I want to talk about the, everything going on in Eretz Yisrael, and of course, YWN has had non-stop wall-to-wall coverage of these arrests that were made in Eretz Yisrael of certain Haredim. I don't want to go into detail right now because I have to reserve judgment until we have all the facts, and things are obviously going to unfold here in the coming weeks. But the point is that the Israeli police, the prosecutors, the media just stand so much to gain from a big arrest and from that type of media coverage, from all the headlines. And for all we know, even if they don't have the evidence for major convictions, they'll still do this just for the anti-Haredi press. And it's possible that they won't end up with major convictions. Now, I'm not trying to be naive here, but let's look at the Rabashkin trial. And remember, that original raid on the Rabashkin plant was all about immigration. It wasn't even about bank fraud or wire telephone fraud, which it ended up being about when Rabashkin was convicted on those charges. And they ended up dropping most of the immigration charges, and the rest of the immigration charges Shalom Rabashkin was actually acquitted of. So it just goes to show you there's so much grandstanding that goes on with these prosecutors. And again, not to be naive, I know there are people out there that don't always do the right thing when it comes to these organizations, and especially with finances. So I don't know, but we cannot just assume because these arrests happened that people are guilty, and especially, you know, people who are close, obviously, to some of the very, very big gedolim in Eretz Yisrael right now. We have to wait and see. But I will say this, and that is anybody in the from world, and that's in the United States or Eretz Yisrael or anybody else for that matter, if you're up to any sort of no good, you're being targeted right now. And we have seen the story again and again. We've seen rebbes who were arrested for money laundering, obviously the Shalom Rabashkin case, and so many others where these prosecutors are out. And we actually spoke to Nat Lewin a few weeks back, and he said prosecutors have run wild in the United States, at least. There's no oversight by the Justice Department. They're able to just pretty much get away with anything, and miscarriages of justice like Rabashkin are happening more and more. And the prosecutors are out for media coverage. And how do you do that? You get the frum, you get the religious, you target them, and when you catch them doing something no good and you charge them, even if you end up with an acquittal, you got the headlines, you got the publicity. So this should be a warning to anybody out there, all of us who are frum, we got to be so extra careful because they are just waiting to pounce, and we have seen that story again and again. We're going to keep you updated on these arrests and how all this unfolds, and of course, check out YWN on a daily basis and an hourly basis. They literally had dozens of stories just on this alone, and they keep us updated on all that's going on in the yeshiva world. Now, I also want to talk about the IDF situation with the Koalisha and with them cracking down on the soldiers who are just trying to keep halacha and just trying to be Shomrei Torah, just trying to just keep halacha. Because as we know, for weeks now, the military and the IDF have been embroiled in this controversy. They are threatening soldiers that they're breaking the rules if they refuse to listen to women singing, and they will simply not back down. Now, the latest is last week, a bill was advanced in the Knesset by Likud Knesset member Tzipi Hotaveli, and that was co-sponsored with a different member of Knesset. And that would actually make it illegal for the military to force soldiers to listen to women singing or to go against halacha in any way. And this has obviously been just a major source of conflict and turmoil right now in Eretz Yisrael. You get the feeling that this law won't resolve the issue, but in fact, it may actually just spark even a larger controversy. There's going to be a big debate probably within the government and within the IDF. And this is amazing to me, because this is the IDF and this is the Israeli government, the not from, going against the Dati Leumi, going against the Mizrachim, going against the Hezder soldiers. They're not going against the Haredim. And isn't this just so telling? Because you always hear the complaints against the Haredim, and the Haredim are just leeching off of the Israeli government. They're just taking money. They're not working. They're not serving in the military. They're not doing anything to contribute to their country. And supposedly, that's the reason that the Chilonim are against the Haredim. The Chilonim are against the Haredim because the Haredim are just sitting there. That's the argument against, and at least one of the arguments, that's supposed to be the justification for everything that goes on against the Haredim. Well, here you have the Hezder are soldiers, and obviously they do so much to contribute to the military and to Eretz Yisrael, to the society over there, and they're supposed to be the good guys. Here they literally give their lives, dedicate their lives to, they do learn in yeshiva, but they also join the army, they join the military, they are part of mainstream Israeli society, and the IDF should be thanking them and should be appreciative and acknowledging that they're supposed to be the good team, not like the Haredim. And yet here they are. All they want to do is keep halacha. All they want to do is keep the Torah, which you think of all the militaries, of all the armies in the world, in Eretz Yisrael, where there is an official religion, you would think that they would actually recognize and acknowledge it and allow them to keep halacha, but they don't. They come down against them, which is just, it's just such bad PR for them. And the fact that they're doing this just really reveals their true agenda. They're not anti-Haredim. They are, by the way. I mean, they have the major problems with the Haredim. But it's not because that the Haredim are so unhelpful and so damaging to Israeli society. It's because the Haredim are from, and the Dati Leumi, the Hesder, are from as well, and therefore they're suffering the same fate as the Haredim. So I just think it's unbelievable that the IDF is doing this, and we obviously applaud the Knesset for making laws that just protect the sanctity of Torah, of Halacha in the IDF, and we certainly hope that that whole issue gets resolved in a peaceful way and the right way. But you get the feeling that there's going to be a lot of debate and conflict here, at least in the coming weeks and months. Moving on, I got to get back to Iran, because I'm so disappointed with the Obama administration, how they're responding. Here Israel is doing the dirty work. Israel is sticking their neck out, putting everything on the line. They have Mossad agents in Iran. Look, we don't know. I don't know that it was the Israelis. And you wonder about the timing, by the way, because this obviously was in some way connected. The day before this this assassination of this nuclear scientist in Iran, the Iranians sentenced an American citizen, American Iranian citizen, to death. They accused him of being a CIA agent. Now, by the way, military experts who don't have inside knowledge say it's very, very likely that he wasn't a CIA or is not a CIA agent, but because of his military background, there are apparently a lot of private business contractors that want to hire people who can speak Iranian and get around Iran, even though obviously it's so frightening for any American citizen to be in Iran right now. But this situation is just horrific, and it seems he, by all accounts, he wasn't even a CIA agent. Obviously, the Iranians have no credibility in their accusation. So the next day, this assassination happens. Now, my first thought was that it was the United States in cahoots with the Israelis, sort of making this statement against Iran tit for tat. But then it actually occurred to me that it could be that the Israelis actually planned it this way. It could be the Israelis are really just looking to do whatever they can against the Iranians, and they'll continue these assassinations. And it could be they set it up to make it look like America was involved because of the timing, when really the United States may have had nothing to do with it. So you really wonder. But the timing, certainly hard to believe it was a coincidence. Now, amazingly, we actually, as I mentioned before, predicted this. And here's a clip of me, Jake Stern, last week on the Jake Stern Show. Israelis are simply just not going to let this happen. Whatever nonsense goes on with the sanctions and the diplomacy and whatever else President Obama tries, the motions that he is going through, the Israelis are much more pragmatic, and they're very, very black and white, very straight shooting, but I don't know what they do exactly. If it's underground and it can't be reached via airstrike, I'm sure the Israelis have a plan. As we know, every few months, some Iranian nuclear scientist gets surrounded by people dressed in black on motorcycles and gets assassinated. Who do you think is doing that? So amazing. There you have it. Now, again, I didn't know that it was going to happen the next day. That show was posted on Tuesday on the Yeshiva World, which, by the way, is redefining Jewish media. And the next day, Wednesday, was when the assassination took place. So, you know, and look, I'm not suggesting that the Mossad is listening to the Jake Stern Show. This might just be coincidence. Now, we know that the Mossad is checking out the Yeshiva World. We know that that's their best shot at finding out everything that's going on in the from world. And we know they're monitoring it. The Jake Stern Show, look, I don't know. You know, we're just getting started here. Probably just coincidence. But you just listen to our show, and you will not just know everything that's going on out there, but you'll even know what's to come. But the administration response, they actually condemned this as an act of violence. Those are Hillary Clinton's words. We had nothing to do with this, and we condemn it as an act of violence. Now, I understand that the United States has to sort of disavow themselves of any connection. Obviously, they're not going to get up and say, well, we committed this act. And they're not going to blame the Mossad, even though, interestingly, the Israelis have been silent. They have not even denied it. But don't act as though it's an act of violence. First off, every country as part of the free world should be getting up and thanking the Mossad and thanking Eretz Yisrael for being there and for doing their dirty work. Now, again, that isn't going to happen. But don't condemn it as an act of violence. Get up and say, look, we had nothing to do with this. However, it's really not such a bad thing, being that we have these sanctions. We probably should be doing a lot more, and being that we're headed toward possible nuclear confrontation here with Iran. The fact that one of the scientists, who apparently, by the way, was an integral part, I'm sure they'll replace him, but an integral part of the nuclear program in Iran, it's not such a bad thing that he has been eradicated. That's what they should be saying. But here you have again and again this timidity on the part of the Obama administration. They're just so afraid of confrontation. They are just so far removed from a President Reagan, who just stared at Gorbachev face to face and, of course, said those fateful words, tear down that wall, and just so many other times that Reagan was just so straight when it came to foreign countries that he felt were threats and dangers to the free world. And President Obama is timid, and it started off this way from day one when he said he would try to negotiate. And he said that he would try to sit down and explain to the Iranians why what they're doing is bad. He has this incredible naivete. He just simply doesn't get the extreme danger. And what I want to share with you is I didn't even realize until last week, when they talk about the Iranians threatening to close off the Straits of Hormuz, I figure, all right, they're going to have some sort of naval blockade, and the United States Navy will take their fleet from Bahrain and other ships and just sort of confront the Iranians and get them out of the way. But it's really not simple. This thing could just become volatile and could so quickly escalate into a major military confrontation, and here's why. As I mentioned at the outset, the Iranians, excuse me, have thousands, and this we know this, we have our intel on this, they have thousands of mines that they are possibly planning to drop all across the Straits of Hormuz. So there are going to be mines all over the place, which would make it impossible, obviously, for ships with oil to cross the straits, because they'd get blown up. Now, the way we would respond is we'd respond with minesweepers, hopefully not just dolphins, but whatever sort of technology we have, we'd respond with minesweepers. Now, we have to get those minesweepers over there somehow. Obviously, we would use ships and carriers to do that. Meanwhile, there's an expectation that the Iranians could respond to that by shooting missiles at our naval fleet, in which case we'd have to respond with airstrikes against their missile launchers. Now, do you realize how quickly this thing could escalate into a very, very major battle? And it just could be a terrible, terrible confrontation. But that's what the Iranians are threatening to do. And our oil prices are already going up because people are afraid of the potential for disaster and catastrophe. And as I always ask, the question is, do we trust President Obama with Leon Panetta? What has he done? He actually trimmed the Defense Department by almost $500 billion, and he was proud of it. And he said, we're turning the page. This is a new era when it comes to the military. Well, what's the new era? The new era is he gutted the military. He's getting rid of 80,000 troops. He's cutting their funding. What timing that he has, as we see the potential for literally disaster and catastrophe in the Middle East. President Obama is doing everything to show his complete naivete and incompetence. And instead of thanking the Israelis, right now the administration is putting intense pressure on the Israelis to not do anything against Iran, to just sort of sit tight and wait and see. Are they crazy? The poor Israelis are sitting there. I mean, they're literally fighting for their lives, and they're just supposed to sit there and do nothing. We have a clip, Joe Biden in 2009, saying that the Israelis are a sovereign nation and have a right to do anything they want to Iran. And yet his own administration, he eventually backtracked, President Obama, as commander-in-chief, They don't seem to agree. And they're telling Israel, you can't do anything because if you attack Iran, then that could lead Iran to retaliate, and that could just be disastrous. You could set off a terrible catastrophe in the Middle East. You could set off literally a war in the Middle East. Who? The Israelis. They're actually setting up to blame the Israelis. They're going to make the Israelis the scapegoat. The Israelis the scapegoat. I mean, it's just unbelievable. You cannot make it up. So we're going to keep you updated on all this stuff because we hope it'll have a happy ending. We pray, and obviously, you know, we all have emuna, and obviously Hashem is running the world. But if you just look at the situation right now, it's very, very scary, and unfortunately, I really don't trust the leadership right now to do the right thing, but we hope the leadership will change in a few months, and we hope there's still time before that happens for things to really correct themselves. All right. We're going to end it right there. We thank you all for being here. The Yeshiva World, redefining Jewish media. We are the Jake Stern Show. Jake Stern at theyeshivaworld.com, the most powerful, thought-provoking analysis of the day's events. We're going to have all the political coverage as the primaries continue here in a few days in South Carolina. Plus, don't forget part two of Rabbi Yisrael Friedman talking all about Shidduchim and the Shidduch crisis. Coming up next time, we will see you then.